what's right and wrong since I've been 10.
Howdy, so this is a really interesting canon of children's literature that's just kind of really busting out right now. And so I've tried to do some rehashing of my lecture from last semester, and I'm not giving it as much as I really should. It's just like I told you in one of the first announcements when this class started, 4 weeks ago, that I'm just kind of, my mind has been blown a little bit about some of the new literature out regarding disabled children's literature. And I realize how much awareness I need myself personally to really present this stuff appropriately. So I went back to this lecture and knocked out some of the stuff and added some more things, but it's got some work to do here, but I will nonetheless move forward with it and give you my take on stuff. So this is a slide I put in several years ago, given my frustration about trying to find any kind of photos, artwork that depicts something other than the dominant culture, right? So a lot of my examples, unfortunately, are of the dominant culture instead of trying to be a little more inclusive with having all sorts of representatives of the disabled culture, because they are in every aspect of our society, right? So a while back, something came up, the ADA, American with Disabilities Act, 1990. So it seems like a long time ago. My twins were born a year after that, so it does kind of seem like a long time ago. But before the ADA Act, some crazy things happened with individuals with disabilities. And if you are interested, you can Google some of that and just see some of these outrageous protests of people with disabilities saying, yeah, we want access too. And actually, when I was growing up, you didn't see people with disabilities that often out in the world, right? A lot of them were housed in some really crazy places, like mentally unhealthy places. So it's come a long way in terms of some access. But as you can hear in any personal cultural narrative from a disabled person, you will understand that we have a really long way to go in terms of access for a big part of our population. So this is an interesting, it wasn't a TED Talk. Oh, maybe it was, Me and My TED Talks. It's in the link, of course, so just watch it. I just want you to watch about the first 10 minutes of it. I just think this person has a great great take on the definition of disabled. So be sure to catch that. I think it gives you a great kind of overview from the perspective of a person with a disability. So I liked this quote. Disability looks like a corollary to diversity, a component that does not hold an important function in the education to diversity in schools. So you got to read it a couple times, but let me just deconstruct. So here's the deal, is that we don't see disability as any part of folding into being inclusive until fairly recently. It just was just kind of an aside, right? We're going to look at other cultures, we're going to look at other stuff, but we're really just going to shove disability over into a corner. And we've done that forever. And my perspective of deconstructing disability children's literature has come from, of course, academic literature. And it's like, again, busting out more than anything now, and makes me realize how much more I need to learn about this culture in order to present it in a respectful manner. So let's see. This is from the article that I gave you. I just think there's some great stuff in there. The representation of disability in children's picture books has long followed the classical tradition of using disabled characters in supporting roles and as foils that reinforce ableist dichotomies central to Western understanding of human worth under patriarchal racial capitalism. Woo, that's a lot, right? So, I mean, it's really true if you look at a lot of children's picture books from the not so recent past and currently, you see that there's sometimes disabled characters in these books, but they play secondary roles all the time. In fact, I saw this. I have this book. I was trying to dig it up to use as an example. I thought, oh, this is a great children's lit book, right? So, because on the front of it, there's all the cover. There's all these, diverse children, including one in a wheelchair. And I'm thinking, okay, cool. And she's going to be in that wheelchair in the rest of the story. Just she disappeared. So she's on the cover. And I think she's in one page, and all the rest of the kids are like all front and present. But the disabled kid has been long gone. So we understand that a lot of times that disabled characters are used as props, or there's in this case in this book, I think it was just thrown in there so you look like, oh yeah, look at the diversity in here, and then just kind of went nowhere. And again, when we look at that understanding of human worth under patriarchal racial capitalism, my take on that is that we're looking at the dominant culture, right? The dominant culture, and which includes, race and class, and so it's all sorts of stuff. So again, to fit into our world, into our children's books, we have to have a standard, right? And so that's interesting. I don't know. That's all I'm going to say about that. This was an example that it's hard for me to find examples in children's books because there's not that many children's books with kids with disabilities. I'll show you some pretty good ones, and it's improving, of course, but perfect example, okay? If you have a disability, you're evil, right? Another great quote: typically, disabled characters in children's picture books have been othered, marginalized, stereotyped as extraordinary. They're sidekicks. They play the role of the outsider. They don't. Their character is never developed, fleshed out. They're not real. I mean, it's like whatever. It's like 2D, right? And then a lot of times, any character with a disability in a picture book or kids' movies don't have happy endings, right? Of course, another Disney example: the Hunchback of Notre Dame, right? He just poor guy didn't get his girl. Again, from the article, which I loved. Sorry, I'm reading a lot on this one. More recently, children's picture books have moved from depicting disability as an ex ex inexorably, inexorably, inexorably marginalized, disempowered cultural signifier to what we call a narrative erasure of disability, an attempt, quite ironically, to prime children to better respect difference. Okay, so this is the one that kind of blew my mind. So I have a list of appropriate children's literature depicting disability, right? And one of them is Susan Laughs, and I had it in my last PowerPoint lecture, thinking, yeah, this one's okay. And this article, as you have read, totally trounces that article because it's erasing the disability, which I think is really interesting. So we're wanting
kids to accept other kids with disability, but what we're doing is moving the disability out of the picture, right? I mean, literally out of the picture in a lot of children's books. Or if we're not moving it out, we're saying, yep, you're just as able, you're just as great as, you know, a typical normal person, right? So it's just so interesting. So I'm kind of mulling this part over. So the narrative erasure of disability. And so in there, what that does is, like, I love this, denies the lived reality of disability. And when you watch the video that's connected with this PowerPoint lecture on Stella Young, oh my gosh, she so rocks this. Like, I think it's my favorite video in this class. And she really talks about that, you know, you can't deny the lived reality of disability, no matter like how perky you can get. So it's just so, it's such an interesting concept. I'm really soaking this stuff in right now. This is the children's book that I thought, okay, yeah, this is okay, but it's not okay, because it's that erasure part, you know, denying the disability by like hiding it. So this book is in the link, and it's a book kind of geared for about a, you know, 2-year-old or so, maybe young three. So there's a lot of repetitive stuff in it, but it also is appropriate for that age. But what's not appropriate is what they have done in terms of her disability. So she's like, Susan does all sorts of, she laughs like you, and she spins, and she throws stuff like you, just a typical kid, right? And she sings like you, and she's, you know, Susan through and through is just like me, just like you. And then the big reveal at the end of the book is that, well, maybe she's not all the way like you, right? Here's her wheelchair, which we never see in the whole story at all. So that's, again, an interesting thing that I'm just kind of mulling over now, is that these books that we are using to supposedly represent healthy images of disabled kids, really a ton of them are, let's just be as normal as possible. And the norm is that standard, right? You have to be able-bodied to be normal. So this is a quote from an article that you are not reading. Unfortunately, even the 21st century, with great gains, there's rich literature for children and young adults, but they speak very little of disabilities in the special child. So I went pomp and put that patronizing on there, which I already have talked about, eliminating that moniker special child. So the term special needs is pitying and patronizing. The assumption less than is built in, as if all people who are categorically lumped together as special needs are incapable of, you know, being real, being smart, have an agency, being in this world. Still a big part of disability literature for children. It is totally patronizing and like, oh, we got to either be really sweet about it all. So generally the promotion, circulation, reception of children picture books remains strongly embedded in an ableist framework. So that's the standard. Being able is the standard, right? And that we have to overcome our disability in order to be like able-bodied people. And that's like a lot of times you see a lot of even children's books that are kind of current saying, oh, well, look how they're overcoming their disability, instead of like folding that disability into their life, because it is their life. So here's some crummy examples that are still being used. It's kind of more of a, you know, again, like the LGBTQ, the first starts of their children's literature canon is more instructional. Like everything is just right on the front page. Not great stories necessarily. We're just going to reveal right away. My friend with autism, a very special critter. My friend has Down syndrome. Our teacher's in a wheelchair. Who cares about disabled people? What's wrong with Timmy? So great example. That's, people love this book, and it's been around, and obviously we're going to find out nothing's wrong with Timmy, because Timmy, if we compare him to the ableist standard, can do just everything he needs to do, even with his disability. And we don't even have any idea what his disability is here, do we? Because again, it's that erasure, narrative erasure of the disability. So again, as we've said with all of our cultures, that we need to have great books, right? We have to have books that show people with disabilities in a real way, and so that we can get rid of some of the stereotypes. Again, that whole let's save the world with children's literature, because we're going to make people more accepting and embracing and celebratory of all of the different cultures we've been talking about. So this I have as a link, not the Best Friends of Pop-Up Book, but I think it's kind of interesting. It's I found it just, you know, doing some Google search about 2 years ago, and it's somebody's master's thesis or something in the UK, and it's she did a pretty good job with it. So just take a peek at it if you want. She's it's maybe a little patronizing, but it kind of gives an idea of, like, you know, why we need good books for with kids reflecting disability culture. So picture books. Yep, we've said it already that picture books are a way that kids soak up everything, right? Soak up what is okay in our culture. I mean, there's so many ways we can influence kids, and influencing kids with rich, authentic children's literature definitely is a plus, right? And if we can get, and we can really discern what our good disability children's literature, then we're on the right track. And I'm kind of getting there myself, really. And so that's why, you know, we put disability children's literature as a culture, right? I mean, we've got to fold that right in into our multicultural canon. So this is kind of cool. I think it's an okay book. I mean, like I said, I'm kind of nervous right now about really assessing what's good and what's not good. And I'm digging more into the literature so that I can make sure that I'm doing it right, or writer, or less wrong. But this is just a read aloud of my friend Isabel. And it's cool because they reveal Isabel, and they reveal the characters in the book because it's based on a true story. So check that out. It's actually one of the better read aloud books. I get so annoyed with the people who read them aloud. Oh gosh, some of them are so annoying. They probably think I am too. But I like this one because it's read by Charlie, I think, the one of the characters in the book. So read it. I mean, or watch it. So I think this is interesting. They have four ways to kind of get us totally thinking differently about disability children's literature, right? So like, just kind of like, let's switch to how we really should view this. Not in a patronizing, not in like a prop for able-bodied people, not as evil or pathetic or sad or patronizing. So obviously just more children's books with characters that are positive, right? Role model figures, like, you know, they're the heroes. They save the world. They do stuff. Let's have books where people with disabilities do stuff, right? And it's just kind of, they do, like, I love the opening of this, I can't say no. I mean, that's so cool. So here's this, what's her name? Allie, I don't know who. So she won the Tony because she's, like, fabulous. She was the first graduate of some really well-known acting college, right? She's like, yeah, what are you doing here? Like, so she's really, you know, trained theater person, you know, with great voice. And she goes in and she does the role of Annie. And it's just so cool because obviously her wheelchair is a whole part of her identity. And so it's there. The wheelchair is there. But we're looking at Annie and we're folding all that in. And I just think it's just revolutionary. So that's the kind of stuff. Oh my gosh, I wanted this to be shorter. Okay, let me keep going. So disability should be taught by presenting, discussing, and critically analyzing quality literature. So here's the thing for me on this part is we need to do it, but we need to do it from the narrative of disabled people, That it's like just like when we're doing the American Indian stuff, right? And we talk about like, why are they telling this story? They don't have an insider perspective. And so the more recent literature that I'm reading and kind of getting like woke about is definitely disability. What they call, you know, crip theory. So it's like being crippled. It's like exciting, interesting stuff. So we want to make sure that we're getting that insider perspective, right? That we need to get it from the culture. And that will help with this, like being accurate and not being cloying and, oh, look at how wonderful Timmy can do this even though he's blind kind of stuff, right? So dialogue is culturally authentic. Yeah, kind of repeating stuff, but really, contributing members of our society, right? Not marginalized, not an aside, not like, wow, it's a miracle that you can do this. I'm so inspired. Not that kind of stuff. And again, you got to watch Stella Young's TED Talk because she really explains that whole inspiration thing pretty good. So I just came across this yesterday, actually. What is today? Is it the 22nd?
I didn't get that.
Oops. Sorry. I'm trying to find out what day it is. Oh, no. Duh. It's the 12th. Okay. Off by 10 days. So I saw this yesterday and I thought, and again, just like stories don't have to be all sad and pathetic. You know, people with disabilities, they're in this world just like we're in this world in that we got all sorts of ups and downs, right? And we don't need to always highlight their downs. So this was an interesting middle schooler who was trying to get her book published and no one would do it. So she did it herself. She did like a jump start, didn't get enough of the money that she needed for the full publication. So she self-published and got her book on Amazon. So it's cool, you know, Maya Lee is wheeling through middle school. I mean, just like, yeah, yep, that's what she's doing. So more of that. That's what we need, more of that. So totally cool, right? All children need to learn about all the diversity. So they need to learn about disability as much as they need to learn about ability or the diversity of ability. That's what I'm supposed to say, right? Whew. So same question I'm always going to ask, right? Just adding another category here. We do it with good books and whoa, I'm a little, let's see what I've got here. I've got to really revamp this maybe. Let me check. Yeah, change the message. Know that one by heart. Acceptance of people. Yeah. So I think this one's still really good. I think this one works. So her brother has, I can't remember what his disability is, but I think it's not too bad. Hopefully this one's okay because a lot of times when we look at people with disabilities, right? Part of some of those quotes is like, yeah, they're super beings or something. But Jane Nolan is really great. So I think she did this respectfully and did make it seem like supernatural stuff, which we can sometimes, right? Okay, Max the Champion. So this one's pretty okay. A lot of times they go, oh yeah, you can do it no matter what, overcome all your whatevers. But I think that this was just like, okay, yeah, I'm doing this race and here's why I'm doing it. And so I'd have to look back up that one again. So now, oh my gosh, I wouldn't do this one. I wouldn't do this because just like me, just like you, they talk about erasure. This because Leah doesn't have her own voice. And I think one of the, and neither did Susan. No, someone else like, you know, did the stuff for her. And for Susan, you know, it was just kind of like, cause it's a young kid's book, 2-year-old, not so, I wasn't as bothered, but I think Leah's voice, I definitely have to get rid of this one because Leah can have her own damn voice, right? In whatever capacity that is, that this looks really patronizing. Ugh, scratch that one. And this one's pretty cool. So I'm going to keep it. If you come across it, read it and let me know what you think. So, okay, we're at the end. Aren't you glad? I'm sorry I rambled on about some of this, but I'm telling you, it's just so, just like I said, I feel like I can apply a lot of what I've learned about disability culture to other cultures. So It's just so fascinating to me. But Stella Young, oh, this is the best, the best. And I just have to tell you, sadly, that she died, I think, about maybe 2 years ago, and having to do with some complications of her disability. But, oh, my gosh, she's the smartest and sassiest lecturer ever. So do for sure watch that. Okay, and then I'm done. Sorry for the rambling on. We're almost through with this class. I'm going to kind of miss y'all. I got to say, you're pretty smart. I really enjoyed your smart stuff. So I have one more lecture, and you will not have to hear me anymore. Okay, take care and keep up with stuff. We're almost there, peeps. Okay, bye.